if you get a chance, I think we're getting coffee on. Introduce yourself to me so I get to know you a little bit better. A number of announcements today, then, for our consideration. First of all, there's been a little bit of confusion for Holy Communion. We're always going two different ways. We're still kind of living into what we're doing. So this morning, what we're going to be doing is we'll be serving from this side and going that way, and then we're going to turn that empty cup bowl over here so that we can come this way and empty our cups into on this side. So hopefully that will take care of a little bit of confusion for Holy Communion. Other announcements are as follows. Don't forget that we have our Lutheran World Relief school kits and getting our supplies together. We're continuing to do so. This is the best time because school supplies are a little more plentiful during the fall as people are getting back to school. Then September 7th, which is coming up very soon, that's on this Wednesday, we are meeting for our senior luncheon at the Breeze Inn. And if you arrive at 11:30, that's just a time to converse and get to spend some time together. So if you come at 11:30, that's great. Don't forget, on Thursday also is council meeting, 7:30 for church council. We know the teams meet individually. They find their own time, but we'll be ready and available at 7:30 for church council. Today, following our worship service, grab your cup of coffee if you're a Sunday school teacher or if you're someone who's interested in Sunday school teaching. We want to meet in the fireside room and we'll have some coffee together and lay out our program. Church book club starts on the third Sunday of the month, September 18th, fireside room. And I believe the discussion for this week is Night Road by Kristen Hannah. So if you haven't picked that up and want to be a part of the church book club, you might want to read that story. Also, teachers and students backpack blessing happen on September 25th. Bring your backpacks and hopefully we'll have a few kids with backpacks to do a blessing with and also teachers. Confirmation orientation, also September 28th, 6 o'clock here for students who are 7th grade and older. And want to make sure that you bring that very important adult, whether it be parent or guardian. We are still seeking an organist and or pianist. Thank you this morning. Joan has been willing to fill in, but we're looking for someone permanent, and that is going to be happening very soon. So if you know somebody, please let myself or Lori or Martha Oswald, so that we can get someone more permanent here for our worship services. Wow, I think I'm exhausted myself just getting through all those announcements. So please read your announcements carefully this week. I also see October, Lake Superior Conference of Welka is presenting a fall gathering. That's a little bit further away. It's an insert in your bulletin this morning. Any other announcements this morning? Well, if there are no other announcements, I invite you to just kind of pause a little bit and take some breaths as we begin our worship service with a prelude. Giving life to us. Our lives flow
well of grace.
Your waters are a gift to us, nourishing the Israelites in the desert, offering healing at the pools of Bethsaida and Siloam, proclaiming Jesus loved in the waters of the Jordan.
Our lives flow from your well of grace.
Your waters are a gift to us, drowning us in baptism, washing away our death, calling us to the work of reconciliation.
Our lives flow from your well of grace.
Your waters are a gift to us, soothing our thirst for justice and peace at home, in our community, and around the globe, carrying us forward to our thirsty neighbors in need.
Our lives flow from your well of grace.
Continue to fill us with your love, that our lives may proclaim Christ's word and deed, care for others in the world God made, and work for justice and peace.
Amen.
We remain standing for our gathering hymn.
Direct us, O Lord God, in all our doings with your continual help, that in all our works, begun, continued, and ended in you, we may glorify your holy name, and finally, by your mercy, bring us to everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
Lesson is a reading from Deuteronomy 30th chapter. See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I am commanding you today, by loving the Lord your God, walking in his ways, observing his commandments, decrees, and ordinances, then you shall live and become numerous. And the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you do not hear, but are led astray to bow down to other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying him, and holding fast to him. That means life to you, length of days, so that you may live in the land that the Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, Isaac, and to Jacob. Here ends the first reading.
Thanks be to God.
I invite you to turn and or we'll take the monitors and let us join in the reading of the psalm. It is Psalm 1. Please follow the biblical letter verses. Happy are they who have not walked in the counsel of the wicked, nor lingered in the ways of sinners, nor sat in the seats of the scornful. Planted by streams of water, bearing fruit in due season, with leaves that do not wither, everything they do shall prosper.
It is not so with the wicked. They are like chaff which the wind blows away.
Therefore the wicked shall not stand upright when judgment comes, nor the sinner in the counsel of the righteous.
The second reading is a reading from Paul's letter to Philemon. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and co-worker, to Apphia, our sister, to Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church in your house, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. When I remember you in my prayers, I always thank God because I hear of your love for the saints and your faith toward the Lord Jesus. I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective when you perceive all the good that we need to for Christ. I have indeed received much joy and encouragement from your love, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, my brother. Now, for this reason, I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do your duty. Yet, I would rather appeal to you on the basis of love. Now I, Paul, do this as an old man, and now as a prisoner of Christ Jesus. I am appealing to you for my child Onesimus, whose father I have become during my imprisonment. Formerly, he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful, both to you and to me. I am sending him that is my own heart back to you. I wanted to keep him with me so that he might be of service to me in your place during my imprisonment for the gospel. But I prefer to do nothing without your consent in order that your good deed might be voluntary and not something forced. Perhaps this is the reason he was separated from you for a while, so that you might have him back forever. No longer as a slave, but as more than a slave, a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in flesh and in the Lord. So, if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has wronged you in any way, or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will repay it. I say nothing about your owing me, even your own self. Yes, brother, let me have the benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I am writing to you, knowing that you will do even more than I say. Here ends the second reading.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise. Let us join in the affirmation.
Daughter, she goes with.
Okay, there we go. And I say babysit with us because we treat them better than babies sometimes. You These are wonderful animals. They become a part of our family. We're going to be talking about family. What does it mean to be family today? Because that's a good question, given the text that we have. What does it mean to be a friend? What does it mean to be family? Now, I don't know if these two guys are friends or not. Seems rather unlikely. One dragon and one bear. This one kind of has a craving for honey, I understand. But just the idea that we have these pets and people who become very important to us. We're going to talk a little bit about what does it mean for us as a church to be family. So thank you for being with us this morning, and God's blessings on your week. Dear friends, in Christ, grace and peace be with you. Amen. Whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Wow, when we hear it, we almost immediately react to that. I didn't expect that. What is Jesus doing here? It's a very frank statement. He doesn't code it. He says it right out, right? And if we were to take that statement at face value, it would probably overwhelm us a little bit, maybe make us wonder, what are we doing here? But should we take the statement by Jesus at face value? And the point is, probably not. The statement is what is called hyperbole. And you know what hyperbole is? It's an exaggerated statement or claim not meant to take literally, but meant to make a point. So what is Jesus' point? What is he trying to say? He's saying that following him is no light matter, no small thing. It will more than likely divide even the most precious of relationships in our lives, and that the cost of those divisions will bring about, can bring about ridicule and may forfeit peace in the family, and those things are hard to find. The division will be so costly that even a negotiator, probably a third party, may not even be able to ensure that peace can be reestablished in that relationship. Now that division and the price of that peace may end up, as it were, costing you not only all that you possess or value, all that's important to you, but even your very own life. That's the statement. The word here for life is a word that also might be better translated soul. So it's not just about one's physical life, but it's about that idea of who we are as a person, that deeper sense of spirituality. I think that we should recall what is taking place. Large crowds are now traveling with Jesus. That's the first statement in that gospel text. Jesus becomes somewhat of a social celebrity. It's easy to see why people are attracted to Jesus. It's easy to see why they want to follow him. He is healing their physical bodies. He's also feeding them with a hope they have never been able to feed on before. Not just any kind of hope, but a hope that speaks of a God who cares about them, who wants to take care of them, a God who overlooks all the things that society makes so important and divides them from other people. But this God is willing to embrace them. That alone sounds fantastic. But Jesus knows what's to come. He knows the scriptures. He knows how this story ends. He knows that persecution is already on the doorstep, and that he needs to be aware so that they become aware, and so he gives them the heads up. Persecution always follows those who upset the social cart. So follow, be a disciple, but be aware. Count the cost. Now the other story in today's text is a perfect example of the upset social cart that we live with. It's the story of Philemon and Onesimus. This story only appears once every 3 years, and it is a complete story. There's only a few verses at the end. Otherwise, this is the complete book of the Bible, as you would call it, this letter to Philemon. So let's just take a look at it for a minute in response to the gospel lesson for today. The first thing we must realize is that Paul writes to his friend
Philemon, who is the legitimate owner of the slave, Onesimus. For whatever reason, Onesimus has come to Paul. He has fled to Paul, who has befriended him, and who considers him a brother in Christ. This is the crux of the letter. Paul is redefining the very social order of his time and affirming that when we become one in Christ by faith, we are no longer somehow divided by the same social orders that the world otherwise uses to divide and separate us. But one in Christ, we are now brothers. Paul is not suggesting that the social order be eliminated, but that in Christ, a new greater order should be observed. And that order is that the new one in and brother in Christ is one that we see as a neighbor now in Jesus. Paul begins by addressing Philemon as his dear friend. He includes his his address in his letter, Ophia, who is Philemon's wife, and Archippus, who is assumed to be Philemon's son. But more importantly, he's writing to the church that is meeting in his home. And so it's written to not only that family, not only that head of the household, but also to those people who gather in Jesus' name. Now there is a gentleness to the letter, but also a very obvious forceful persuasion that is taking place here in the letter. Paul is aware that as one who brought Philemon into the family of faith, that Philemon is spiritually indebted to him. Let me tell you a little side story from my family. As missionaries are often, they create families and churches in foreign countries. And my dad, as a young pastor, he was young at that time, by the way, he's very old now, but as a young pastor, he had a young boy who came. His father was an alcoholic, and he came, and my dad gave him a job. What they were doing was they were putting benches together for a church. It was on the outskirts of town. They were starting a church out in one of the bayous of our town. And this young boy, his name was Carlitos Horst, he's a good German boy, he became indebted to my father because my father introduced him to the faith. And the funny thing is, Carlitos, who is now 70, just last year came to visit my mom and dad in Houston. That's not the first time, that's the second time he has come to the United States just because he's afraid that he wants to have that one last conversation with my dad, who he feels indebted to because of this faith relationship, and before my dad passes away. And that's what he talks about. Before Pastor Gray passes away, I want to make sure I thank him once again. I want to thank your dad. So Paul now has this sense of indebtedness to convince Philemon to take Onesimus back, not just as a slave any longer, but as a fellow believer. Now, two things. Paul appeals to Philemon's depth of commitment to his faith and to Christ, placing Onesimus' life on the line. Now, that's the way it was. It was also in Philemon's rights as the owner of this slave who has run away to have him incarcerated, or more importantly, he could even have him killed. On Onesimus' side, it was Onesimus' faith that caused him to somehow make his appeal to Paul to advocate for him, knowing his life is on the line. And so he goes to Paul and says, "Please, be an advocate for me." And so Paul writes this letter to his master. It's hard to know how this all worked out. What is happening here is exactly what Jesus speaks about in Luke. Faith in Jesus is redefining what it means to be family. The family was all that one had in the early church. These were perilous times, and the social order of the day meant that one could only trust in those who were blood relatives to take care of them. What Jesus has done is he has made us one in Christ, upsetting the social order of his time and introducing a new social order to love neighbor as self. There is no greater love than this that a person has when he lays down his life for a friend. friends in Christ, one in Christ. It becomes a piece of the cross we bear to the world in Jesus. Paul appeals to that friendship when he writes this letter. In fact, he says, I could command you to do your duty, yet I would rather appeal to you on the basis of love. I wonder this morning if Kenwood has come to realize just how much love plays a part in uniting us in Christ. Sometimes we live in that somehow this unity that is so much a part of both church and society that is around us, always picking out somehow differences, always demanding conformity. But my hope is that here, this congregation, we would appeal to the unity God calls to us in Christ, in love. Listen to Paul. So if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you have welcomed me. We say, and it's on our side, all are welcome. For me, that is not an appeal to some perfect, caring, loving church, but it is the welcome we find in Jesus. A new way of looking at things, a new kind of love that defines friends and family. By removing the lines that so often separate us, we are family in Christ, white and black, male and female, married and single and divorced, searching for those who have grown up in the faith. In Christ, in love, we are one. That is my hope. It is the oneness that is the peace that we seek, and the peace that we can only find in Christ. May this be our aim. May this be our song. May this be our life. I invite you to join in our hymn. It's as an insert in the bulletin.
He is seated at the right hand of the Father,
and you will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us join together in the prayers of intercession. As scattered grains of wheat are gathered together into one bread, so let us gather our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of God's good creation. We pray for the church around the world and for the mission of the gospel. Refresh the hearts of your people, deepen our understanding of everything good we share, and strengthen our partnership in the faith. God of grace, hear our prayer. For the well-being of the earth and all its creatures, for trees and forests, for all that will yield fruit this season, and for streams and other bodies and waters, God of grace, hear our prayer. For the nation and those in authority, for the elected leaders of our towns, states, and country, and for international organizations, grant wisdom to those who govern, and raise up citizens who make decisions in the best interest of their neighbors. God of grace, hear our prayer. For all in need, for those who suffer from disease, who struggle with homelessness, for food insecurity, for those whose family life is difficult, and for all in this community who need your care. We especially think this morning of students going back to school and those returning to colleges and universities as well. God of grace, hear our prayer. For this community of faith, for all who labor, begun, continued, and ended in you, that they glorify your holy name. Bless your people with the strength to live into their many vocations for the sake of the world. God of grace, hear our prayer. We give thanks for the saints who now rest from their labors. Give us faith like them, to love with all our hearts, and by your mercy, bring us to everlasting life. God of grace, hear our prayer. Gather together in the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, gracious God, we offer these and all our prayers to you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Well, thank you very much. So now, thank you. Share the peace with each other this morning. When you've exhausted sharing your peace, which I'm sure will take on for a long time after, especially during coffee time, when you're totally exhausted, we still offer our gifts of thanksgiving to the goodness of God, and so we receive our offering this morning at this time. I invite you once again to stand as we join in the great Thanksgiving. Almighty and merciful God, hear our Savior Jesus Christ. who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth, and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and joy their unending hymn. Gathered into one, let us join and pray the prayer of Jesus.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. abundant table. You have refreshed our hearts in this meal with bread for the journey. Give us your peace on the road that we may serve our neighbors with joy. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I invite you to rise and receive the blessing. God gives life to all things and frees us from despair. Bless you with truth and peace. And may the Holy Trinity, one God, guide you always in faith, hope, and love. Amen. You remain standing for our sending hymn. It is number, as you are able, number 838.
With Christ beside you.
Thanks be to God.